Good evening. Good evening. My name is Pete Peterson. I am the incoming interim dean of the Pepperdine School of Public Policy. It is a great pleasure to welcome you all here. This is one of a series of evening conversations that we've been co-sponsoring with the Trinity Forum, such a terrific relationship. We have dubbed this series The Moral Sense in Politics and Policy. That title is taken from a very important book by the late James Q. Wilson. Wilson, who many of you know, was a leading political scientist of his era, but he was also very involved in helping to found the Pepperdine School of Public Policy. In many ways, The Moral Sense as a book really does encompass a lot of the work that we do at Pepperdine and what makes us such a unique master's program in public policy. And I'll just put the plug in there for any prospective students, if you are looking for a different, more holistic graduate program in public policy and you don't mind moving to Malibu, I invite you to speak with me after this discussion. I bring you greetings from the planet Malibu. Yeah. Or as I like to say, we consider the desolation of smog something that we describe the 1980s weather conditions. But it's especially appropriate that I am here tonight, both with Cherie, but also with Joe Loconte, talking about the subject of friendship. If there's anything that we do well at Pepperdine, is understanding that there's more than just the mathematics behind good policy. There is culture, relationships, and history. And we had the great pleasure of having Dr. Loconte out to be one of our visiting professors several years ago, and that's where he and I first became friends. I think Malibu and Washington, D.C. share quite a bit, actually. You're known as a city of great and long-standing friendships, as Malibu is. That's a joke. You know, it was interesting, as I was prepping for my remarks, I just went back and looked because I had seen a television ad for a new movie out. You know, if you looked back at a newspaper in 1983, you would have seen that our governor was Jerry Brown, and that a new movie called The Terminator starring Arnold Schwarzenegger was coming out. And they call California a progressive state. Apparently not much has changed. So again, it's a great pleasure to welcome you here. This has been a part of a two-year series, which we definitely look forward to continuing, the subject matter of the moral sense and how it affects our politics and policy is something that we take very dearly at Pepperdine. And without further ado, I'll welcome up Cherie Harder from the Trinity Forum. Thank you all.
Thanks, Pete, and I'll just add my welcome to all of you to tonight's evening conversation with Joe Loconte on his new book, A Hobbit, A Wardrobe, and A Great War: How World War I Inspired J.R.R. Tolkien and C.S. Lewis to Recover Heroism, Friendship, and Faith for the Modern Age. We at the Trinity Forum have been delighted to partner with Pepperdine and Pete Peterson at the Pepperdine School of Public Policy. I practiced that. This is the latest in an ongoing series, as Pete mentioned, to talk about the moral sense in politics and policy. And we are just so grateful to the generous sponsorship that Pepperdine has made available to explore this often combustible mix of faith, morality, and politics in a civil, thoughtful, and yet provocative forum. And so just wanted to welcome Pete, as well as Rich Gathrow, who is the director of the Washington office of Pepperdine, as well as a number of Pepperdine students. We're really excited to have you here tonight. We're also delighted to have each of you here tonight. Some of you might know, especially if you're in the far back reaches over there, we actually had to shut down registration and have a full house. So if you wanted to have friends here or weren't able to bring them, or if you had friends who wanted to come, come and couldn't, we will be recording tonight's evening conversation, and we'll be posting the video to our site at www.ttf.org, where you are welcome to add your comments, as well as you can check out our Facebook page and our Twitter feed for some video, photographs, and comments there as well. For those of you who aren't familiar with the Trinity Forum, we work to provide a space and resources for the discussion of life's greatest questions in the context of faith. And we do this by providing readings and publications which draw upon the classic works of literature and letters to connect the timeless wisdom of the humanities with timely issues of the day, as well as programs such as the one tonight to connect leading thinkers with thinking leaders and engaging those big questions of life, and ultimately, coming to better know the author of the answers. We also hold Socratic forums around the world, including an annual forum at Rhodes House for Rhodes and Marshall scholars, to enable and equip leaders to grapple with those questions, to live and lead more wisely, and to connect the timeless truths with those issues that confront us. And so this year, which marks the 100th anniversary of one of the most pivotal moments in history, World War I, or the Great War, as it was called. It was a time of extraordinary upheaval and uncertainty, which permanently altered the political and cultural landscape of the West. Over the course of the next few years, after the start of the Great War, the sense of optimism and growing faith in progress and technology that had characterized the early 20th century would seem to be betrayed and lost. By the end of the Great War, there were over 16 million dead worldwide, over 10 million soldiers and 6 million civilians. And of course, the numbers of the wounded were far greater. The advances in science and technology that had offered so much promise for a healthier, wealthier, better life for so many more had been instead used to kill more efficiently and destroy more completely. And the extent of the carnage and the slaughter prompted a widespread and bitter questioning of traditional authority and belief, including faith and the notion of divine goodness or justice. A century later, we face new uncertainties, new threats, and new tragedies, but we grapple with many similar questions. Is there a good God who can be trusted? How do we understand and resist the extraordinary evils of our age? And amidst disillusionment, cynicism, fear, and despair, how do we discern the good, understand our times, and work to redeem them? Our speaker tonight will grapple with such weighty questions through offering a case study of the life, work, and friendship of two extraordinary writers, J.R.R. Tolkien and C.S. Lewis. Both men served as soldiers on the Western Front, survived the trenches, and used the experience of that conflict to ignite their imagination of the true, the good, and the beautiful. Out of utter desolation, Tolkien and Lewis breathed new life and new vigor into a literary tradition that affirmed the concepts of heroism, sacrifice, friendship, and divine grace. It is a remarkable and a gripping story, and it's hard to imagine someone who can present that story more eloquently, enthusiastically, or energetically than Joe Loconte. Joe is an associate professor at the King's College in New York City, where he teaches Western civilization and American foreign policy, having previously served as a distinguished visiting professor at the Pepperdine School for Public Policy. He's also been a senior fellow at the Ethics and Public Policy Center, as well as the Heritage Foundation, where he served as a William E. Simon Foundation, and last but certainly not least, has served as a distinguished senior fellow for the Trinity Forum. A prolific writer and commentator, he's written for the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, the Washington Post, the New Republic, the Weekly Standard, and NPR, as well as a few international credits, where he is a regular contributor to the London-based magazine Standpoint, as well as Italy's La Stampa. Finally, his four books now include The Searchers, The Quest for Faith in the Valley of Doubt, The Light Tome, God, Locke, and Liberty, as well as the cheerful The End of Illusions, Religious Leaders Confront Hitler's Gathering Storm. And finally, the book that we've asked him to come and talk to us about tonight, A Hobbit, A Wardrobe, and A Great War. Joe, welcome.
Thank you. Well, before I start offering some thank yous, I should come clean with you people. I know you came here to hear a talk on Tolkien, Lewis, and the First World War, but really, I'm here to announce my campaign as candidate for President of the United States. I mean, there's room for one more, right? I mean, come on. I could do as good as you here, Pamela. You're laughing over there. And I have a campaign slogan, too. I have a campaign slogan. I picked up this slogan when I was in southern Italy in Naples. I was lost in Naples. I lost my passport. Poor Joe, stuck in Naples. And I find myself in the midst, literally in the midst of an Italian election campaign, and there's a farcical candidate. His picture and his slogan are plastered all over Naples. Here's the slogan. Farò niente, ma lo farò molto bene. I will do nothing, but I will do it very well. So that's my winning slogan, all right. But Cherie, thank you so much. At the Trinity Forum, you know, there's no organization I'm prouder to be a part of than the Trinity Forum. There is no organization like it here in Washington, really any place, doing the kind of cultural renewal work that they're doing that is so vital. And Cherie, a friend of many, many years, there are many qualities that you have that have been such a gift to me. Two come to mind, loyalty and generosity. Thank you, friend, for this amazing event. Pete Peterson, I had the privilege, as Pete mentioned, of getting to know there in lovely Malibu. And whether Pete is campaigning for high office in California or serving as interim dean over there at Pepperdine, he is a man without guile. Thank you, friend, for being here. Terrific to be with you. I want to thank all of you for coming. I am just astonished by this turnout. It's like it's my funeral or something over here. Thank you so much for coming. It's a remarkable, it's a testimony to the enduring, of course, attraction of Tolkien and Lewis, which is great. I can't help but think, though, as well, of my family, the journey that Loconte family has taken to get here to the National Press Club. I think of my mom and my dad, my siblings, but I think of my grandparents who had to endure the catastrophe of the First World War. My maternal grandfather, Giuseppe Aiello, for whom I'm named, he left Italy in 1921 when he was 17 years old, 1 year before Mussolini and the fascists swept into power. Nice timing, Grandpa, thank you. And then my paternal grandfather, Michael Loconte, Michele Loconte, he was living in the United States when war broke out, and the Italian army wanted to draft him. The Americans said, look, we'll give you this option. Fight for us, and we'll make you a U.S. citizen. Not a hard choice. Well, he goes to the Western Front in 1918, serves with the American Expeditionary Force, 91st Division, Charlie Company. I don't know how much suffering he saw. He must have seen a good deal of it, but his 91st was part of that final assault that really brought the Germans to their knees. And so I think about them, and I wonder what they would be thinking and say. If they were here right now, what might they say? I think they'd say something like this. Giuseppe, che cosa fatto qui? Joey, what are you doing here? What have you done here, Joey? Catastrophe, mamma mia. That's what I think they'd be saying right now. All right, let's get into it. The last soldier to die in the Great War was an American, Henry Gunther, a private with the American Expeditionary Force in France. He was killed at 10:59 a.m., November 11th, 1918, 1 minute before the armistice went into effect. He was 23 years old. Gunther's squad had encountered a roadblock of German machine guns near the village of Chaumont-d'Aviler. And against the orders of his sergeant, he charged the guns with his bayonet. German soldiers, aware of the armistice, tried to wave him off. But Gunther kept coming, and he was gunned down, and he died instantly. His divisional record states, almost as he fell, the gunfire died away, and an appalling silence prevailed. Well, despite the parties and the parades marking the end of the First World War, a brutal and appalling silence fell over much of the world. It was the stillness of souls anguished and bewildered by the carnage of the most destructive war the world had ever seen. Historian Paul Johnson has called the conflict the primal tragedy of modern world civilization. the main reason why the 20th century turned into such a disastrous epic for mankind. Winston Churchill, who fought in the war, described it this way: injuries were wrought to the structure of human society which a century will not efface and which may conceivably prove fatal to the present civilization. Well, they called it the war to make the world safe for democracy, the war to end all wars, the war to usher in the kingdom of heaven. Instead, the Great War laid waste to a continent and destroyed the hopes and lives of a generation. Before it was all over, nearly every family in Europe was grieving the loss of a family member, or helping others to grieve, or caring for a wounded soldier struggling to adjust to civilian life. Like no other force in history, the First World War permanently damaged the mental outlook of European society. It ushered in a season of cynicism and agnosticism toward the values and the ideals of the West. For a generation of men and women, it brought the end of innocence, and it brought the end of faith. And yet, for two extraordinary authors and friends, J.R.R. Tolkien and C.S. Lewis, the Great War deepened their spiritual quest. Both were thrown into the mechanized slaughter of the Western Front, an experience that would shape their literary imagination. Tolkien creates, of course, The Hobbit and The Lord of the Rings, one of the most influential books of the 20th century. Lewis earns fame for The Chronicles of Narnia, the series of children's books, now ranked among the classics. It could be argued, friends, that these epic tales involving the sorrows and the triumphs of war, think about it, of war, would never have been written had these authors not been flung into the furnace of combat. Listen to Winston Churchill. Battles are won by slaughter and maneuver. The greater the general, the more he contributes to maneuver, the less he demands in slaughter. Well, the generals of this war demanded much in slaughter. By the time of the armistice, nearly 10 million soldiers dead, millions more wounded. On average, there were about 6,046 men killed every day of the war. Every day of a war that lasted 1,566 days. Tolkien and Lewis might easily have been among their number. As a second lieutenant in the British Expeditionary Force, Tolkien spent many days and nights under fire on the Western Front. He fought at the Battle of the Somme, one of the fiercest concentrations of killing in the history of human conflict. Listen to Tolkien reflecting on this experience. One has indeed personally to come under the shadow of war to feel its full oppression. He says, it now seems often forgotten that to be caught in youth by 1914 was no less hideous an experience than to be involved in 1939 and the following years. By 1918, he says, all but one of my close friends were dead. Also commissioned as a second lieutenant in the BEF, Lewis was sent immediately to the front, arriving on his 19th birthday. Any 19-year-olds out there in the audience, out of curiosity? 19th birthday on the Western Front. Happy birthday. The experience of 6 months of trench warfare, a vortex of suffering and death, remained with him throughout his life. My memories of the last war, he said, haunted my dreams for years. Well, like Tolkien, Lewis lost most of his closest friends in the conflict. By the mid-1920s, Tolkien and Lewis both arrive at Oxford University, where they take up their vocations as instructors in English literature. They meet for the first time in 1926, and a bond of friendship is established that will transform their lives and their careers. Tolkien plays a crucial role in Lewis's conversion from atheism to Christianity, while Lewis persuades Tolkien to pursue his story about hobbits and to complete The Lord of the Rings. Well, think about it. Given the massive influence of their works, it is hard to think of a more consequential friendship in the 20th century. We need to step back, I think, and try to appreciate how out of step these authors were with their times. Both men write these epic tales awash in the themes of war, sacrifice, valor, friendship. They create these mythic worlds torn apart by a struggle between good and evil. They use the backdrop of a global conflict as the crucible for moral and spiritual growth. Ladies and gentlemen, these are not the kinds of stories that people are writing in the post-war years. Many veterans compose fiercely anti-war novels, memoirs, poetry, a large cohort of educated men and women become moral cynics. They sneer at the very idea of heroism or virtue. In the years after the conflict, the cruelty and the senselessness of war, of any war, for any reason, become the dominant motifs of a generation. Think of the works of Robert Graves, Goodbye to All That, Siegfried Sassoon, Memoirs of an Infantry Officer, Ernest Hemingway, Farewell to Arms, T.S. Eliot, The Hollow Men, Eric Remarque, All Quiet on the Western Front. The watchword is disillusionment. Disillusionment, a fierce cynicism about liberal democracy, Christianity, and the achievements of Western civilization. The shell-shocked veteran, and there are thousands of them wandering the streets of Europe in the post-war years, many of them in insane asylums, literally. The shell-shocked veteran becomes a walking metaphor for most, or at least much, of post-war Europe. Remember the main character in All Quiet on the Western Front who expects to return to civilian life weary, broken, burnt out, rootless, and without hope? Well, this mood is acute, yes, among the writers, the artists, the public intellectuals, but it affects ordinary middle-class Europeans as well. Listen to historian Richard Overy in his book, The Twilight Years. Dismay was a mainstream concern, he says. For the generation living after the end of the First World War, the prospect of imminent crisis, a new dark age, he says, became a habitual way of looking at the world. Although his Catholic faith remains intact, J.R.R. Tolkien bemoans what he described as the collapse of all my world that began with his deployment to the Western Front. Well, trench fever takes Tolkien out of the war. He's demobilized from the British Expeditionary Force, July 16, 1919, moves back to Oxford with his wife, Edith, and infant son, John. He wins a professorship of Anglo-Saxon at Oxford, 1925. But his early academic success cannot ease the heartache of war. He experiences a time of sorrow and mental suffering. The loss of so many friends to the war produces, in the words of his children, a lifelong sadness. C.S. Lewis went into the war as an atheist, and he came out an atheist. He was an atheist in a foxhole. He wrote a war poem with these lines: "For all our hopes in endless ruin lie, the good is dead, let us curse God most high." That's Lewis in 1917, 1918. Wounded in combat in April 1918, Lewis is sent to a hospital bed in Bristol, where he writes to his father, "I could sit down and cry over the whole business. Nearly all my friends in the battalion are gone." He returns to Oxford January 1919 to resume his studies in the classics. A few years later, he records in his diary, this is fascinating, a conversation with a guy named the Doc. And the Doc is the uncle of a fellow soldier who himself was a war veteran. Kind of a shell-shocked war veteran, this guy, the Doc. Well, they go for a walk one evening, and here's what he wrote in his journal, what Lewis wrote. "I don't know how, but we fell to talking of death and all the other horrors hanging over one. The Doc said that if you stopped to think, you couldn't endure this world for an hour. I left him and walked home." Well, many post-war thinkers and writers, in fact, are unwilling to endure the world in its current form, and a kind of spiritual vertigo takes hold, a frantic search for solutions to the human predicament. Freudian psychology, spiritualism, scientism, socialism, these and other ideologies are attempts to solve or to explain away the horrors that seem to be hanging over the human race. And so by the 1920s, these ideas are gaining ground rapidly in Europe and in the United States. Listen to historian Modris Eckstein's, "A profound sense of spiritual crisis was the hallmark of that decade, the 1920s. It affected rural laborers, large landowners, industrialists, factory workers, shop clerks, urban intellectuals." Well, having said all that, what's the point? These facts make the literary aims of J.R.R. Tolkien and C.S. Lewis all the more remarkable, because they reject the moral agnosticism and the ambivalence that infect so much of the output of their era. Critics, of course, accuse these men of nostalgia and medieval escapism. Well, these authors, yes, they wrap their tales in fantasy and in myth, but they do this in order to convey hard truths about the human condition, its darkness and its futility, as well as its virtues and its nobility. As Lewis explained, and man as a whole, man pitted against the universe, have we seen him at all till we see that he's like a hero in a fairy tale? Tolkien and Lewis are attracted to myth and romance not because they seek to escape the world, but because for them, the real world has a mythic and heroic quality. It's the setting for what? Great conflicts and great quests. It creates scenes of remorseless violence and suffering, as well as deep compassion and valor and sacrifice. Let's try to unpack their vision a bit, friends. First, let's try to unpack this bottle of water. First, Tolkien and Lewis are utterly realistic about the corrupting influence of power. They are utterly realistic about the corrupting influence of power, the desire for power, the desire to dominate others, often disguised by appeals to religion or to morals, is a recurring theme in their works. Virtually no character in their stories is immune to the temptation. In Lewis's Prince Caspian, Nicabrick, initially a soldier in the fight for Narnia, turns traitor when Aslan, the great lion, fails to come to their aid when they call him. Nicabrick makes the appalling suggestion that his comrades enlist the help of the White Witch. You may drop Aslan out of the reckoning, he says. We want power, and we want a power that will be on our side. In Tolkien's trilogy, we learn that Saruman, this wizard originally committed to helping Middle-earth in the struggle against Mordor, has fallen under the sway of the Ring of Power. Prudence, he argues, demands a temporary compromise with Sauron, the Dark Lord. We can bide our time, he says. We can keep our thoughts in our hearts, deploring maybe evils done by the way, but approving the high and ultimate purpose. Sounds like Washington, D.C., doesn't it? Well, here the effect of the Great War is manifest, isn't it? Despite an appeal to lofty moral principles, none of the combatant nations resisted using the most horrific weapons available against the enemy. Mortars, machine guns, tanks, poison gas, flamethrowers, starvation. Listen to Winston Churchill. When it was all over, torture and cannibalism were the only two expedients that the civilized, scientific, Christian states had been able to deny themselves, he says, and these were of doubtful utility. I wish I could write like that. And remember the social aftermath of the war. Communism, fascism, Nazism, eugenics, these are the revolutions and the ideologies that arise in the exhaustion of the democracies of Europe, all in the name of advancing the human race. All began by promising liberation from oppression. All became instruments of totalitarian control. Tolkien and Lewis are acutely aware of these ideologies, and they react against them in their writings. They have no illusions about the corrosive influence of unchecked power. Second, Tolkien and Lewis recover the concept of heroism in an age of moral cynicism. Heroism in an age of moral cynicism. The heroism in their stories is not defined by a single act of bravery. The hero is the product of a well-formed character. Character. Think about it. The hero emerges because of a series of choices to put the welfare of other people ahead of his or her own desires. The industrialized slaughter of the First World War, this is worth underscoring, the slaughter of that war had damaged the very idea of choice, of moral agency, of free will. After all, think about it. Millions of men had been flung into the heartless machinery of a conflict that robbed them of their humanity. They were mutilated, bombed, bayoneted, gassed, incinerated, obliterated without mercy. The utter helplessness of the individual soldier on the Western Front is a recurring theme of post-war literature, and this spirit of fatalism begins to extend to society at large. Here are just some book titles from the 1920s and 30s. Some of them on my bookshelf now. 1920, The End of the World. 1921, Social Decay and Degeneration. 1923, The Decay of Capitalist Civilization. 1926, The Twilight of the White Races. 1927, Spengler's The Decline of the West. Also in 27, Will Civilization Crash? 1928, the day after tomorrow, what's going to happen to the world? 1931, the problem of decadence. And 1933, Auden's The Dance of Death. How about that for a book club title at Loconte's house? Come to Loconte's, The Dance of Death. Bring your own black shroud, friends, right? Must explain my social life, but enough about me now, enough about me. Tolkien and Lewis reject this mental outlook, this fatalism, and they insist that every person is caught up in a great moral contest and that our choices in this contest matter, and they matter supremely. Remember the scene in the Chronicles of Narnia, in The Horse and His Boy, when Shasta and Erebus, helped by the talking horses, they race across the desert to warn Narnia of the approaching army of Rabadash, bent on its destruction. And before reaching their goal, they're attacked by a lion. Erebus, further behind, is moments from being cut down by this beast. Now Shasta has a choice to make. "Stop," bellowed Shasta in Bree's ear. "Must go back. Must help." Shasta slipped his feet out of the stirrups, slid both his legs over the left side, hesitated for one hideous hundredth of a second, and jumped. It hurt horribly and nearly winded him, but before he knew how it hurt him, he was staggering back to help Erebus. Now, scenes like this would have been familiar to many combatants in the Great War, the image of the soldier throwing himself into harm's way to rescue that fallen comrade. Think of the scene in Lord of the Rings when the hobbits encounter Lady Galadriel and they gather before her and she fixes her eyes on each of them and she delivers that warning. "Your quest stands upon the edge of a knife. Stray but a little and it will fail to the ruin of all." Well, what are they to do? Each of them is faced with the appalling clarity of the choice laid before him: to continue in the quest into certain danger and deprivation, or to take the safe and the easy way and to turn back. Listen to Tolkien. "All of them, it seemed, had fared alike. Each had felt that he was offered a choice between a shadow full of fear that lay ahead and something that he greatly desired. Clear before his mind it lay, and to get it, he had only to turn aside from the road and leave the quest and the war against Sauron to others." So this bedrock belief in the responsibility to resist evil, the responsibility to resist evil, it gives the writings of Tolkien and Lewis their dignity and their power. It's the reason I think that their stories, so fantastical in style, seem to speak into our present reality. The war against evil is the moral landscape of our mortal lives, isn't it? Whatever form that evil takes in our world, we are called to resist it. By insisting on our responsibility to confront evil, Tolkien and Lewis retrieve the medieval concept of the heroic quest. The heroic quest. Think of Beowulf or the death of Arthur. And they reinvent this quest for the modern mind. In an era that exalts cynicism and irony, Tolkien and Lewis seek to reclaim this older tradition of the epic hero. The epic hero. Now, why? Why? Why did these two authors, ignoring the most powerful trends in their culture, embark on this task? Well, part of the answer, I think, it lies in the battlefields of France. It was there, as young soldiers, that they encountered these virtues in the officers and the privates and the medics at the Western Front. It was there, according to Tolkien, that the inspiration for his most beloved mythic character occurred. Where did Tolkien get his idea for The Hobbit in the first place? Well, after he became a professor at Oxford, he's sitting and grading student papers. Got any teachers out there in the audience, teachers? How many of you like grading papers? Yes, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Same for Tolkien. He's just beside himself with these papers that he's grading. He finds a blank sheet of paper. Oh, finally, a blank sheet of paper. And he scrawls these words on the blank sheet of paper: "In a hole in the ground, there lived a hobbit. In a hole in the ground, there lived a hobbit." He just wrote those words, didn't know why he wrote them. And later on, reflecting, he says, "Eventually, I thought I'd better find out what hobbits were like." Well, we now know what hobbits are like, don't we? From Tolkien's own account, the character of the hobbit is a reflection of the ordinary soldier, steadfast in his duties while suffering in that dreary hole in the ground, the frontline trench. Many of the members of the British Expeditionary Force were citizen soldiers. And even during the most intensive campaigns along the Western Front, the British Army showed a remarkable resilience, according to one historian, relative to other armies. They didn't break and run. They didn't suffer a breakdown in morale or mutiny. The change in character that comes over Sam Gamgee in The Lord of the Rings is not unlike that transformation that Tolkien must have witnessed among his fellow soldiers in battle. Listen to Tolkien. "Even as hope died in Sam, or seemed to die, it was turned to a new strength. Sam's plain hobbit face grew stern, almost grim, as the will hardened in him, as if he was turning into some creature of stone and steel that neither despair nor weariness nor endless barren miles could subdue." One of the most beloved heroic figures in modern literature is based on Tolkien's firsthand knowledge of the virtues of the men in the trenches in the Great War. Listen to Tolkien on this. "I've always been impressed that we are here, surviving, because of the indomitable courage of quite small people against impossible odds. My Sam Gamgee," he says, "is indeed a reflection of the English soldier, of the privates that I knew in the 1914 war and recognized as so far superior to myself." Well, the same could be said of any number of characters in Lewis's stories for children. Often it's the humblest, right, or the smallest, the mouse named Reepy Cheep, who displays the greatest valor on the battlefield, right? As soldiers, Tolkien and Lewis lived among these small people, witnessed their courage under fire, joked with them, mourned with them, and watched them die. As veterans of the most destructive war the world had ever seen, they cannot, this is worth emphasizing, they cannot glorify its violence or its anguish, but neither can they accept the fatalism and the cynicism that has become so prevalent. Wilfred Owen's raging anthem against war, the shrill, demented choirs of wailing shells, it can't be the final word, not for them. And so we have this concept of heroism, reinvigorated and reinterpreted for the modern mind. Third, Tolkien and Lewis uphold the importance of friendship. Friendship in our common struggle against evil. The heroic quest is not a solitary endeavor. Historian Stephen Ambrose reminded us of this truth with his book, Band of Brothers. Who's seen the movie, read the books? Anybody, Band of Brothers out there? Okay, all right, all right. Herb, I thought you only saw those chick flicks. All right, good for you. Just kidding, Herb, just picking on you. Band of Brothers, the story of the men of E Company, America's 101st Airborne. During the Second World War, listen to Stephen Ambrose. "Within easy company, they made the best friends they ever had or would ever have. And this fact about the experience of combat was as relevant for the soldiers who went off to fight in 1914 as it was for those in 1939 or 1941. For Tolkien and Lewis, their personal knowledge of the fellowship of men under fire, it must rank as another defining experience for their literary lives. Lewis first established friendships like these with his brother Warnie, also a soldier in the British Expeditionary Force, whom he called his dearest and closest friend, who understood the anxieties of combat, and a guy named Lawrence Johnson. Lawrence Johnson, who fought alongside Lewis on the Western Front and shared his love for literature and for philosophy. And reflecting years later, Lewis declared that this guy Johnson, quote, "he would have been a lifelong friend if he'd not been killed. He was moving toward theism, and we had endless arguments on that and every other topic whenever we were out of the line." You get the picture? There's a lull in the bombing, and they're arguing theology, these guys. Well, the theme of friendship pulses through each of the Narnia stories, doesn't it? It's like a force of nature. It might even be said that friendship replaces romance as the preeminent expression of love in Lewis's stories. It flourishes among the children, between the children and the noble Narnians, and between Aslan and all who serve him in love and obedience. Listen to Lewis turning to the experience of war to explain what distinguished the love among friends from all other earthly loves. He says this, "You'll not find the warrior, the poet, the philosopher, or the Christian by staring into his eyes as if you were his mistress. Better to fight beside him, read with him, argue with him, pray with him." It's the same for Tolkien, who is devoted to his inner circle of friends at the King Edward School in Birmingham, his band of brothers. In 1916, they held their own war meeting in London. They called it the Council of London, expecting to be sent into the theater of war at any moment. And at that meeting, they shared their deepest hopes and dreams for the future. Tolkien, reflecting later, says this is where his sense of vocation was quickened with those men in that room on that day. Is it a coincidence, ladies and gentlemen, that the concept of friendship amid the suffering of war is one of the great themes of The Lord of the Rings? Frodo, Sam, Merry, Pippin, Aragorn, Legolas, Gimli, Gandalf the Grey. It's called the Fellowship of the Ring, right? The Fellowship of the Ring. When Frodo arrives at Crick Hollow, before setting out into the Old Forest, he's determined to leave on his own, right? He doesn't want to expose his companions to the perils that lie ahead. And yet Merry and Pippin and Sam, they are wise to his plans, and they confront him before he can slip away. They insist on coming with him. Frodo protests, but it does not seem that I can trust anyone. Merry is unflappable. It all depends on what you want. You can trust us to stick to you through thick and thin to the bitter end, and you can trust us to keep any secret of yours closer than you keep it yourself, but you cannot trust us to let you face trouble alone and to go off without a word. We're your friends, Frodo. We know a good deal about the ring. We're horribly afraid, but we're coming with you or following you like hounds. Well, there's a question for us. Do we have a few friends following us like hounds? Well, the bond of friendship between Sam Gamgee and Frodo Baggins is one of the moral triumphs of the work. Remember when they were at the threshold of Mount Doom? Near the very end of their quest, they are weak from thirst and exhaustion. They're nearly overwhelmed by the desolation of the landscape, right? The lack of another living thing, the black skies, the noxious fumes, the ash and the slag and the burned stone and the smell of death. It is a scene not unlike what Tolkien experienced at the Battle of the Somme. They stagger toward their goal. Frodo, weakened by the great burden of carrying the ring, begins to crawl on his hands. Listen to Tolkien. Sam looked at him and wept in his heart, but no tears came to his dry and stinging eyes. I said I'd carry him if it broke my back, he muttered, and I will. Come, Mr. Frodo, he cried. I can't carry it for you, but I can carry you and it as well. So up you get. Come on, Mr. Frodo, dear. Sam will give you a ride. Just tell him where to go, and he'll go. I suspect, ladies and gentlemen, that only individuals who knew friendship of this kind, who experienced it in the field of combat, could write passages of such grit and courage and nobility. Well, after the war, Tolkien and Lewis sought to recapture something like the intense comradeship that sustained them during the crisis years of 1914-1918. So at Oxford, they launch the Inklings. The Inklings, those who dabble in ink, the group of friends and fellow scholars who meet weekly to read and to discuss their work, and to have a pint or two, or three. Well, Tolkien helps Lewis to find a publisher for his first science fiction novel, Out of the Silent Planet, back in 1938. Most importantly, it was Tolkien's conversation with Lewis on the night of September 19th, 1931. They talked until 2 in the morning about the nature of myths and about Christianity as a true myth. It was this conversation that Lewis himself described as the immediate human cause of his conversion to Christianity. Well, for his part, Lewis becomes for Tolkien his great advocate for pursuing his hobbitry. As Tolkien described it, Lewis's gift was his sheer encouragement over many years to keep on. Listen to Tolkien. He, C.S. Lewis, was for long my only audience. Only from him did I ever get the idea that my stuff could be more than a private hobby. But for his interest and unceasing eagerness for more, I should never have brought The Lord of the Rings to a conclusion. Well, when Lewis learns that The Lord of the Rings has been accepted for publication, he writes a letter to Tolkien describing his sheer pleasure of looking forward to having the book to read and to reread. And then he reveals the importance of the book to both their lives with these lines. Listen to Lewis. So much of your whole life, so much of our joint life, so much of the war, so much that seemed to be slipping away into the past is now, in a sort, made permanent. Do you catch what he's saying? In this trilogy, Tolkien has somehow captured something of the essence of their life together in a mysterious way. Here is a glimpse of what friendship can look like when it reaches for a high purpose and is watered by the streams of sacrifice and loyalty and love. All of this, ladies and gentlemen, is part of their achievement, but I think they accomplished something else. We cannot overstate how profoundly subversive and countercultural the works of Tolkien and Lewis were in their own day and remain so in our own. The soldiers of the First World War lived through endless days of mud, stench, slaughter, and death. Nothing like it had ever occurred in the history of the world. It shook the very foundations of civilized life. Listen to Churchill. All the horrors of all the ages were brought together, and not only armies, but whole populations were thrust into the midst of them. T.S. Eliot saw the post-war world as a wasteland of human weariness. I think we're in Rat's Alley, he wrote, where the dead men lost their bones. Well, after returning home from this war, Tolkien and Lewis might easily have joined the ranks of the rootless and the disbelieving. Instead, they faced the problem of war and suffering with realism. Realism, but not resignation. For them, there is no shortcut to the land of peace, no primrose path to the mansions of the blessed. First come tears and suffering in Mordor, heartless violence at Stable Hill, and horror and death at Golgotha. Their stories insist that we do live in a moral universe. War is a symptom of the ruin and the wreckage of human life, but it can inspire noble sacrifice for humane purposes. War would sometimes be necessary, they concluded, to preserve human freedom. Remember the words of Faramir, captain of Gondor, in Lord of the Rings. War must be, he says, while we defend our lives against a destroyer who would devour all. But I do not love the bright sword for its sharpness, nor the arrow for its swiftness, nor the warrior for his glory. I love only that which they defend. Well, these giants of literature created mythic and heroic figures who nevertheless make a claim upon our concrete and ordinary lives, don't they? They challenge us to join with them in their struggle against the dark forces of this world. And it is a desperate struggle, ladies and gentlemen, isn't it? And this leads us to the most surprising element of their achievement. In the worlds created by Tolkien and Lewis, this struggle against evil is only possible because there's a source of grace and goodness outside of ourselves. We can only struggle against evil because there's a source of grace and goodness outside of ourselves. For all the accusations of medieval escapism, Tolkien and Lewis come closer to capturing the tragedy of the human condition than any postmodern cynic. Think about it. By the end of the quest, Frodo, the ring bearer, he's given up the thought of ultimate success or even survival. Hope fails. An end comes, he tells Sam. We have only a little time to wait now. We are lost in ruin and downfall, and there's no escape. At the climax of his journey, at the fires of Mount Doom, despite all of his courage and strength, Frodo fails in his quest. He fails. He chooses not to destroy the ring, but instead succumbs to its power and places it once again on his finger. I do not choose now to do what I came to do. The ring is mine. Tolkien explained that scene this way. But one must face the fact, he said, the power of evil in the world is not finally resistible by incarnate creatures, however good they may be. Here's where Tolkien and Lewis depart most radically, I think, from the spirit of the age. Think about our modern tales of virtue and heroism, right? The gallery of the superheroes, super cops, super spies. We've got a protagonist who always saves the day by his or her natural intelligence, strength of will, good looks, usually lots of firepower at hand, right? It's America, Second Amendment, baby, right? I believe in the Second Amendment. Don't panic out there. Don't panic out there, guys, all right. But that's the modern hero, right? Well, the moral vision in the works of Tolkien and Lewis is fundamentally different. The hero cannot, let me underscore it, the hero cannot, by his own efforts, prevail in the struggle against evil. The forces arrayed against him, as well as the weakness within him, make victory impossible. The tragic nature of his quest begins to dawn on him, to oppress him, until the moment when a final failure seems inevitable. And now the mythic dimension of their stories reaches its zenith. Like the best fairy tales, they provide the consolation of the happy ending, what Tolkien called the sudden joyous turn toward rescue and redemption. It's the reversal of a catastrophe, what Tolkien calls the eucatastrophe. The eucatastrophe, a decisive act of grace, which promises to overcome our guilt, restore what's been lost, and set things right. Frodo's defeat, which is really our defeat, is overturned by a power stronger than our weakness. Tolkien identifies this power as, quote, that one ever-present person who is never absent and never named. And so it is that Gollum, driven by his lust to dominate, bites off Frodo's finger that bears the ring, only to slip and to plunge to his death, right? Into the fire. Well, the ring is destroyed, but not by Frodo. Not by the fellowship, but by a sudden and miraculous grace. In Lewis's children's stories, the crowning moment of grace occurs in the last battle as King Tyrion, the children, and a faithful remnant of Narnians fight their way to the entrance of the stable, the last battle of the last king of Narnia. Spoiler alert. Okay? We are led to believe that inside the stable is certain death, the stronghold of an all-powerful evil. I feel in my bones, says Bogan, that we shall all, one by one, pass through that dark door before morning. I can think of 100 deaths I would rather have died. Well, as the company is forced inside its doors, all hope seems lost. And here again comes the joyous turn. The great lion has invaded the stable, cast out the demon Tash, and turned the stable into a portal to Aslan's country. The children watch as Narnia is destroyed, and a new world, nearly more beautiful than their hearts can bear, is called into being. Listen to Lewis. As the old Narnia, all the old Narnia that mattered, all the dear creatures have been drawn into the real Narnia through the door. And the character of Lucy. Lucy captures the simple yet powerful symbolism of the stable. In the gospel accounts, it's the birthplace of the Messiah, the lion of the tribe of Judah, of Jesus in Bethlehem. In our world too, Lucy says, a stable once had something inside it that was bigger than our whole world. These epic tales of rescue and sacrifice are strangely familiar to us, aren't they? Because we've heard them or rumors of them before. For these two giants of literature, there was only one truth, one singular event that could end the long war against evil and undo the tragedy of the human condition and bring lasting peace. The return of the king. The return of the king. In Narnia, this king, of course, is Aslan, the great lion. Only Aslan knows the way to that blessed realm that lies beyond the sea. The light ahead was growing stronger, writes Lewis in the last battle. Lucy saw that a great series of many-colored cliffs led up in front of them like a giant staircase. And then she forgot everything else because Aslan himself was coming, leaping from cliff to cliff like a living cataract of power and beauty. This king comes in power and in beauty as the voice of conscience and the source of consolation as the lion and the lamb. Here is the union of tenderness and severity, as Lewis put it, of terror and comfort intertwined. In Tolkien's story, this king is Aragorn. Aragorn, the chief epic hero of the Lord of the Rings. Heir to the kingship of Gondor, his life is devoted to the war against Sauron. But his true stature is made known only after Sauron's defeat, when he finally assumes his throne. Listen to Tolkien. But when Aragorn arose, all that beheld him gazed in silence, for it seemed to them that he was revealed to them now for the first time. Tall as the sea kings of old, he stood above all that were near. Ancient of days he seemed, and yet in the flower of manhood. Wisdom sat upon his brow, and strength and healing were in his hands, and a light was about him. And then Faramir cried, "Behold the king." Here is a vision of human life that is at once terrifying and sublime. Here is a world, our world, in which every soul is caught up in an epic struggle against evil, a story of sacrifice and courage and clashing armies, the return of the king. This is the day, ladies and gentlemen, when every heart will be laid bare, the day when we will know with inexpressible joy or unspeakable sorrow whether we have chosen light or darkness. It is in these imaginative works of fiction, these mythic tales of heroism and sacrifice and redemption, that we find a clue to the meaning of our earthly journey. Is everything sad going to come untrue? Asks Sam. For the creators of Narnia and Middle-earth, this is the deepest source of hope for the human story. The belief that God and goodness are the ultimate realities, and that the shadow of sin and suffering will finally and forever be lifted from our lives. The great war will be won. This king, who brings strength and healing in his hands, will make everything sad come untrue. Thank you for listening. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And I think we've got a little time. How much time, Cherie, for Q&A? About 10, 15 minutes of Q&A. Mr. Palafoudis. Away from the mic, and also, if you could structure your question, to borrow from my friend Eric Metaxas, structure your question in the form of a question. That would be lovely.
First of all, damn you, Joe Loconte.
How'd you get in here?
You'll get a question in 1 second, but your words made me cry. And I don't like you that well. that you could make me cry. When Charles Colson died, everybody at the funeral got a lapel pin. It said, "Remain at your posts.
Yes.
Do your duty."
I remember that.
How would you think that Tolkien and Lewis would tell us today, what is our post, what is our duty?
Terrific question, John. Thank you for that. You know, they felt their own particular sense of calling and vocation was in writing and literature, right? That's the genre, that's the field that they wanted to be successful in. That's part of the reason they devoted themselves to meet together in the Inklings to help each other become the best at their craft. I mean, you can imagine those settings with these great writers sitting around for a few hours critiquing each other's work. Tolkien said that he read virtually every chapter of The Lord of the Rings out loud to C.S. Lewis, either in the settings of the Inklings or one-on-one, every single chapter, because Lewis had a particular gift for criticism, constructive, brilliant criticism when he heard things read out loud. Tolkien knew that, and he wanted that. So this commitment to their craft was so crucial. And so they met for, I think, 16 years, more or less, every week, every Thursday, also I think on Tuesdays at the Eagle and Shaw, but in Lewis's rooms, right through the Second World War, right through the chaos of the Second World War, these guys are meeting because they're so devoted to helping each other become the best at the craft. I think that's the initial thing I would say, is we have to make some commitment to that as we understand our own individual callings, to say, before God, I want to be a person of integrity and excellence in this craft, because I know at the end of the day, that's going to have ripple effects I can't anticipate. They could never have anticipated the influence that their writings had, right? But they were devoted to this other thing, excellence, integrity. Thank you, John. It's just scratching the surface. Yes, over here, and please tell me your name.
Chris
Seymour. Yes, Chris, thank you.
Joe, first of all, thank you for coming to talk to us tonight. I've really enjoyed your speech. If you'll permit me, I'd like to read a quote from a fellow Englishman to these guys, perhaps a generation or so earlier. And I was wondering if you could talk to us about what they may think about this quote.
Okay.
War is an ugly thing, but not the ugliest of things. The decayed and degraded state of moral and patriotic feeling which thinks that nothing is worth war, is much worse. The person who has nothing for which he is willing to fight, nothing which is more important than his own personal safety, is a miserable creature indeed, and has no chance of being free unless made and kept so by the exertions of better men than himself.
Yeah, thank you for that quote. You know, it's a great question, because there was in the post-war years, in the 1920s, and this is one of the benefits, I guess, of trying to teach American foreign policy and history, and I say constantly, thank God the students come in as such blank slates, they don't know what I don't know. angels of mercy protect us. But you do figure out something about those post-war years. The reaction against the First World War was a kind of mood of pacifism and a withdrawal and an unwillingness to face unpleasant realities. Now, neither Tolkien nor Lewis went into the war as holy warriors, right? There was a good deal of kind of holy war rhetoric in the First World War from the ministers. Not so much from the guy in the trenches, though. But they did not come out of the war as pacifists, even though they certainly came out very sobered by that. Lewis wrote in 1941-42, the Second War is on, he says, we know from the experience of the last 20 years, meaning from 1918 to 1938, we know from the experience of the last 20 years that an angry and fearful pacifism is one of the roads that leads to war. He's reflecting on that decade of appeasement in the 1930s that allowed fascism to rise unchallenged. So I think, you know, part of their response would be, war is horrible. War is just about the worst thing that can happen to human beings. And yet there are some things that are even worse, and it's and you see this through both their works. What I love about these heroic figures is they're reluctant warriors so often. They're filled with self-doubt and struggle, and they're not triumphalist even when they win. They're surprised that they've won the battle. They win the battle and they're stunned that they won. And so there's a realism, I think, about combat and war that they experience, that they infuse into their stories. But also, they're not going to give up on the idea of a just war, of a war for decent and humane and noble purposes. They won't give up on it. Yeah, a necessary tonic, maybe. Let me get maybe somebody over here in the shadow cabinet over there. If they want to have a hand, a question over there, because you guys are out there in those bleacher seats, and I just felt for you the whole time out there in the shadows. Anybody there? Just give them a chance. Okay.
I'm in this direction.
You're part of the shadow cabinet, John. Go ahead.
Thank you. I would say, one, that your talk was full of hope and very inspiring, and I appreciate that, and with humor. We obviously take this talk in light of contemporary, or the society, the world that we're living in today. And would you have any, when we're obviously talking here in Washington, D.C., what would you say are some insights you've had in researching this book that might be helpful for some of our national leaders?
That's a great question, John. Thank you for that. You know, what stands out to me about these men, one of the great things about working on this book is you get into the writings, the journals, the letters of these men, which they never intended to publish, and your admiration for them just grows. It deepens. I think part of what these guys were able to do, which is so manifest in their stories, is to avoid these two extremes that became so popular in their day. They avoided the extreme attitude of kind of militarism, utopianism. On the one hand, you know, we can change the world, remake it in our own image, whether through war or through some ideologies, through some revolution. They avoided utopianism, but they also avoided cynicism. And they navigated between these two emotional, psychological extremes. And they did that through their lives and through their writings. And I just do sometimes wonder if we could use a little bit more of that at all kinds of levels, right? It doesn't mean their stories aren't just filled with these very gripping tales of kind of good versus evil. Yet those elements are there. But there's an awareness about the tragedy of the human condition, and that comes out of their Christian understanding of the human person, the tragedy of the human condition, and yet, with the grace of God, amazing things can happen. With the grace of God, but with the cooperation of the individual. Individual wills matter. So they avoid the cynicism, they avoid fatalism, they place a supreme emphasis on individual decision-making, don't they? Individual decision-making throughout their stories. It's just shocking to me. From the first page to the last page of both their works, people have choices to make, whether it's an animal or a human form, you've got choices to make for good or for evil. That is just a theme throughout. So I think this awareness of the fundamental dignity of the individual, the importance of individual choices, is another huge, hugely important theme that's worth recalling. Yes, how about that young lady in the back? And tell me your name.
Hi, my name is Emily Latafe. I really liked your comment about how friendship is emphasized more than romance in Narnia and in Lord of the Rings as well. And I was wondering if you could talk about why our culture today seems to value romance more than friendship.
Wow, it's a terrific question, which is way above my pay grade and experience. It's a terrific question. Boy, let me see if I can scratch the surface of that one. Why has friendship taken this sort of back seat to romance? Look, here's one possible answer. I don't know how helpful it's going to be. But when I think about the friendships that these men formed, they were friendships about, not for their own sake, but friendships for the sake of a great cause, a great and noble cause. And that's where the friendships are forged. And it seems to me one of the dangers problems we've gotten into in our culture is we have this idea about friendships that it's kind of just holding hands and sharing precious promises. And there's no great cause to attach ourselves to. There's no crucible of conflict. There's no challenge to which we have dedicated ourselves in friendship. And if you don't believe that there are great causes worth being a part of, great moral truths to attach yourself to, that is going to weaken friendship, I think. It's going to undermine friendship. It's the belief in great moral truths, great challenges, a force of evil in the world. That's what animates the friendships, right, in both their great epic tales. Take away the moral landscape. Take away the idea of good and evil and great transcendent truths that are worth fighting and dying for, and you don't have, there's no friendship story. There's no point to the friendship, right? What's the friendship going to be about? So I think that's part of the reason. And so if that's part of the problem, the weakening of belief in these great truths, animating truths, the weakening of friendship, well, what is going to fill the vacuum most easily? It's going to be romance. It's just so easy. It's so tempting, right? And there it is. That's a partial answer. Thank you for that question. I can't do it justice. Thank you, though. Who else? Right here. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And tell me your name again.
Ryan.
Yes, Ryan.
My question is, you briefly alluded to the World War II in their writings, but how much of an effect and in what way did it have on their outlook on the world and their writings themselves?
You're talking about World War II now?
Mm-hmm.
Terrific question. You know, Tolkien was actually, they assumed that when The Lord of the Rings came out in the 1950s, that it was an allegory, a warning against atomic power. The ring was just a great allegorical symbol. And Tolkien says explicitly in a letter, he says, of course it's not about atomic power. It's about power and the desire to dominate. That's what he says the books are about. That's what he says the books are about, the desire for power, the desire to dominate. How did the Second World War, well, in the Chronicles of Narnia, of course, we have the whole children fleeing London business. We have that whole setting. But Tolkien acknowledges, says that he began writing bits and pieces of this epic trilogy while he was in a dugout in canteens under fire, bits and pieces and fragments he's writing in 1916, 1917. He's beginning to forge this mythology that he wants to give to his beloved England, this new mythology. So, because my focus is on the First World War, I was filtering, you know, my study through that. So I think at the end of the day, look, they both have a lot to say. If you go into their writings about during that period, 1940, 41, 42, they are so often hearkening back to the First World War and what it meant. Tolkien writes a letter to his son, Christopher, serving in the Royal Air Force. And his son is anxious about the war, what's going on. And Tolkien writes to him and says, I know what it's like to feel like you're the toad under the harrow. You're in this dangerous, dangerous place. But he says, remember that you're inside a very great story, trying to encourage his son. And he also says in that letter that it was that during that time, when he was in that place in the First World War, that he began to use his writing as a way to somehow express in a constructive way the struggle and the grief and the sorrow that he was experiencing, to give it an outlet, a constructive outlet. So I'm not really getting at your question, but the 1940 war, the 1939, 40, 41 war, in a sense, it was a confirmation in many ways, I think, of the narrative power of their stories. I think it's part of the reason there's a rejuvenation of Tolkien and Lewis after the war years. Their story of the human tragedy, the tragedy of the human condition, now seems to be playing itself out again in the Second World War. Two more questions, okay. This gentleman over here, and then we will come back over here. Yeah, tell us your name, would you, sir?
Hi, I'm Niksad Horiat. I'm here with the AI Values and Capitalism Conference. And my question is how you would think Lewis and Tolkien would answer the question of how to know the world and still love it. They obviously knew the pains and evils of the world in a very specific way, having gone through World War I. So they obviously produced books to be for the good of the world and true and goodness of the world. So just your thoughts on that.
Boy, that's a terrific question. I'm thinking here of Lewis and what so characterized his journey to faith and then so characterized his life. And he had been through a lot, just like Tolkien. Lost his mother at a young age, First World War. He's caring for an elderly woman through much of his life. All kinds of struggle and hardship. But the experience of joy that Lewis learned to make part of his life, the ability, the capacity to stop and to appreciate beauty, physical beauty or moral beauty, he developed that capacity. And I think that's a learned trait. I'm not sure it comes naturally to us. I think we have to decide we're going to stop and appreciate. So, for example, while he's still an agnostic, but he's moving toward theism, and I'll try to quote as closely as I can. He's on a train. He's been injured in three places. A mortar goes off, injures him in three places, takes him out of the war. He's on a train to recover at a hospital in England, and he's crossing through this beautiful English countryside. And he writes in a letter to his friend after he arrives at the hospital, "You can't imagine how beautiful that train ride was. The sight of the sea, which I have missed for so long, and the sight of the poppies, the gold in the fields." And then he says, "I'm beginning to think that there is some source of beauty beyond this natural world, but I don't know what it is." And it begins to capture him. The experience of joy and beauty. So I think developing that capacity, developing that spiritual muscle, if you will, I think is probably a crucial part of the answer. We all have it, but I don't think it's going to happen naturally, and there's so much that drowns it out and discourages us from exercising that muscle. Does that help a bit? Yeah. What else? Who else? We had somebody over here. No? Yeah, go ahead, sir.
Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah.
My name is Mark Charles. I just moved here from the Navajo Reservation in Arizona.
Well, welcome.
So thank you. I really appreciated your comments today. As a huge fan of C.S. Lewis, I was not aware of his firsthand experience with the war and of how he was using his books to make people aware of the horrors of the war and write about it in his, or bring some of those themes and help the audience wrestle with those themes. As a Native American living in the United States, one of the things that we suffer, that we wrestle with is our history that's been marginalized and dehumanized. And so how do you think, I'm trying to think how to best phrase this question.
Yeah.
Tolkien and Lewis brought a dialogue regarding the horrors of war to their audiences. As a nation, we tend to celebrate our exceptionalism, and yet we don't know how to talk about the fact that 30 lines below the statement, "All men are created equal," in our Declaration of Independence, it refers to natives as merciless Indian savages.
Yeah.
How do you think what they did with the war can and should be done today to help our society deal with its own horrors of its own history?
Yes, yes, great question, thank you for that. You know, one of the things I do in my Western Civilization class that I teach there at the King's College, these poor students who are, got some King's College students here someplace who've endured Loconte's ranting. Thank you, guys. Thanks for coming. Came back for more punishment. Good to see you. And I think I still start those classes with a little film clip from a Clint Eastwood classic, The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, that great spaghetti Western. And the point there is to introduce my students to the idea that Western civilization and the American expression of it has the good and the bad and the ugly. And what we're going to try to do in the class, what I think we should do in our own respective spheres, is we should go into this past with our eyes open and, again, avoid the extremes of cynicism and utopianism. And it seems to me that, that's another acquired sort of discipline, mental discipline, which really, is, I guess, suggests a character issue as well, though, too, at the end of the day, the ability to navigate between those two. So when you think about Lewis and Tolkien in their writings, again, I don't think these guys are glorifying war. I don't think they're trying to glorify their country's role in war at all. And part of the reason I say that is when you think about the characters in their stories, almost all of them are prone to a great temptation and a fall. They're all vulnerable to the lure of the lust for power, the will to power. There's almost no one who's really immune to that, right? But then, on the other hand, there's almost no creature who's beyond redemption. So even a Gollum, you remember the line there, Gandalf talking about Gollum? About this creature who may have a part to play yet in all this. I mean, Frodo wants to get this creature and kill him. And Gandalf says, no, mercy. Mercy, he may have a role to play. So holding out hope, and even Frodo begins to adopt that posture toward Gollum. Maybe this creature, this wicked, seemingly irredeemable creature could be redeemed. So I think it's that perspective of realism, yes, but not cynicism, not utopianism, and not fatalism would help us as we evaluate our history and come to grips with it. I think that's the best tonic at the end of the day. Thank you for that. Are we out of time for questions? Thank you so much for coming, everybody. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe, for that. For those of you who are new to some of Joe's work, we will have copies of A Hobbit Wardrobe and a Great War for sale for $25. Hot off the presses. When was the release date, Joe?
Today.
Today is the release date, so literally hot off the presses. We commend that to you, encourage you to take advantage of that just outside. Also, each of you should have on your chair another thing that we would invite you to take advantage of, and that is an invitation to join the Trinity Forum Society. The Trinity Forum Society is a membership organization that really makes programs like this that we do at the Trinity Forum possible. At a time when we are largely a divisive as well as distracted society, there are very few opportunities for people to come together in civil, hospitable, and yet rigorous dialogue about what matters most. And we try to provide programs that make those kind of opportunities possible. And our membership society is what helps make that possible. And so we commend that to you. As a special inducement to join the Trinity Forum Society today, if you do, we'll offer you a free copy of A Hobbit, A Wardrobe, and A Great War as a special inducement. Help avoid the line. Joe will sign it for you and so on. Right outside the doors, there will be a table where we'll be selling those copies. Joe will be signing, and you can join the Trinity Forum Society. If you have any questions, simply see one of my colleagues, Margaret Eberly, if you could raise your hand, is a font of wisdom and can probably answer any questions that you have. In addition to that, there are several other benefits. All members of the Society get our daily What We're Reading curated recommendation feeds on reading, our monthly podcast series with interviews with different thought leaders, as well as our quarterly readings, which try to bring one of the classic or best of contemporary pieces of literature and letters to you, along with explanations about why they are still relevant and important, and discussion questions in the back, so they are essentially a book club in a bag. So I hope you will avail yourself of that opportunity. If you'd like to share this event with others, please feel free to either log on to our website where you can watch it and share the video link, or to join our page on Facebook, tag photos. We'll have some posted in the next 24 hours and then in a larger batch in the next 48 hours or so. And as well as our Twitter feed where we'll be commenting on Joe's remarks tonight. Finally, it seems only appropriate to end with thanks. Certainly, there's much to be thankful for. We really deeply appreciate the generosity of our partners, the Pepperdine School of Public Policy, so ably represented by Pete Peterson. So we appreciate your sponsorship of tonight. We also wanted to thank photographer Zach Miller, who's been running around taking a lot of photos, which you will soon be tagging on our Facebook page. There, I have great appreciation for my remarkable colleagues at the Trinity Forum, who do not get to be up here in front, but are the ones who make all of this possible. Margaret Eberly, who is our very able events coordinator and membership director. Colleen O'Malley, Alyssa Abraham, our executive assistant and office manager, as well as our spectacular interns, Nathan Tolles, Elizabeth Wilson, and Adam Spears. Yes. Finally, thank you again, Joe, for your comments tonight. Thank you for coming, and good night.